a man who sailed to sea, and he told us of a life in the land of submarines. So we sailed up to the sun.
I'm
need a place to hide. Oh, I believe in yesterday. Why ain't she had to go alone? She wouldn't say. I said something wrong now I know. For yesterday, it's such an easy game to play. I need a place to hide away. Oh, I believe in yesterday. That's all we have to say. It's our latest record.
Thank you.
disappear. I see that road before me. It always leads me here. Lead me to your love. While has left a of tears, crying for the pain. Why leave me standing here? Let me go.
Thank you. Welcome to Metabolic Physiology in Isolation, MetFist 2020. I'm joined here today by my cutest assistant, Juju. Say hi, Juju.
Hi.
You want to wave? She's helping me today. We've mentioned this before, every day. Metabolic Physiology in Isolation is a new model for truly inclusive global science. Not only is it cost effective, anyone can listen to it anytime, anywhere. And we're really enjoying the fact that we've been able to provide some of this open access for all, no matter where you are and where you're listening from. It's also green. It's nice that we're not flying, all of us flying some to some destination to get on the show. You want to watch Baby Wah Wah Wah? All right. Sorry to interrupt you. We're putting on Baby Wah Wah Wah. I'm sure you all have the same difficulties at home. Can you find it? Is that the one? The sick baby? There you go. And so we're glad that we're able to bring this to you from the White Megara Lab. Cassidy, get ready. This is your turn. You've been keeping up this challenge. We're in for day 7. Can you get another Inception photo? I'm looking forward to seeing this one on Twitter. I have also enjoyed all the battles online with the different features. We've gotten past the teacup phase. Now we're getting to the cute stuffy phase. Sarah Gray went in with her pancreas. That looks really cuddly. And then Sarah Shuck went out with two of the beetles. It looks like she's a big fan of the Clippers. That's right. She's got Paul George there on the counter. And who didn't love the photo of Birdie May? I think she's definitely won the cutest toothless smile for MetFist 2020. We don't need to go to battle on that. It is won. It is done. She is gorgeous. Thank you for listening, Birdie May. None of this would be possible without all the fantastic speakers that volunteered very quickly. This took only 1 week to set up almost a month worth of talks, and that's because these people volunteered their time despite knowing that they'd be stuck at home with families and other challenges they didn't know how they were going to deal with. They said, yes, let's get on board. Let's get out here. Let's present. Let's keep metabolism alive. Let's keep the community together. And I'm really grateful to them for that. You all are too, I've seen. The best way you can say thank you is you can speak to them in the Twitter space, MetFizz 2020, after their talk, during their talk, before their talk, ask them about their work. If you see them in person, give them a high five, tell them thank you. If you're in a line at a coffee house, buy them a coffee. Tell them what you really enjoyed about their talk. I'm sure that's really going to touch them. And make sure to remember these faces. There's going to be more faces to remember. I'm going to release the speaker list for another 2 weeks. Very shortly. I think you're all going to be excited. We've got a killer lineup that's going to just keep continuing. So thank you to those new speakers that have agreed. You'll see this is going to be brilliant. If you want to thank me, if you want to thank me, you can. I wouldn't be here without the Pathway to Stop Diabetes program. If you have a spare dollar and you want to say thank you to me, that would really honor me. I've added the web link there so you can go check out the Pathway program. But you don't need to do that to be part of this. You don't have to donate anything, just your time and listen and enjoy. Share with your colleagues. All the links to access these talks are online on the White McGrath Facebook page. All the talks go live, go up on YouTube once they're finished. And they're live on Facebook. So if you have trouble getting in through Zoom, you can go over to our Facebook page and, you can go, that's my nose. You can go online and check those out. Right now I'm going to transfer over to Tony, but just before I do that, I want to let you know we've got another amazing speaker coming up tomorrow. That's right, day 8 of MetFist 2020 is happening tomorrow, right here, right at this time, where we'll hear from Paul Titchnell about the regulation of muscle metabolism by insulin signaling. That stands to be an amazing talk. Make sure you tune in. As with all the talks, they're going to be great. And so that's all I have to say for now. I'll see you in the Twitter space. Enjoy the talks. Tony, over to you. I'm going to make you the host.
Hello. I'm not sure I'm on the video. Okay, I guess. Okay, here I have someone who wants to be in the competition for the best toothless smile. Okay, smile. Okay, that's good enough. Okay, it's my turn. All right. So I hope everything looks good. Sorry about that. Okay, so hi everyone. My name is Tony. I just started my lab and the Department of Molecular Metabolism in Harvard Chan School of Public Health about 3 months ago. Sorry, I don't see my video. Okay, I just got a message from Phil that everything is great from your side. Just need to, okay. So I was able to set up my lab. It took 3 months and I was able to run one experiment. But before it was turned shut down for this situation, it's completely fine, of course, in times of this. But it's great that we can still connect to people in the field with this virtual conference. So thanks again to Phil and the White McGrath Lab for organizing this fantastic virtual seminar. It's really an honor for me to share my research with such a large audience on the internet. And I hope you can learn about one or two things about circulating metabolites from me today. Obviously, I'm not going to talk about any result from my old lab. The work I'm going to talk about was done in my postdoc lab, Josh Rabinowitz's lab at Princeton. I worked closely with a talented graduate student, Alex Cohen, on many of the things I'm going to talk about today. This, of course, would not be possible without contributions from many of the lab members shown here. Also without, I want to thank my collaborators in the Joe Bauer lab and the UPenn. I have been supported by a pathway to independence award from ANDDK of NIH. The work I'm going to talk about today is included in the preprint, which is available on Bauer Archive. So I want to start with something very obvious. We're fueled by food. So at the level of overall chemical reaction, we're not that very different from cars. The cars burn gasoline into CO2 to get energy, and we burn burgers into CO2 to get energy. But unlike cars, where the only part that burns fuel is car engine, we consist of many different tissues or organs. Think about brain, muscle, lung. Each of them require fuel source for their energy. So as shown in this illustration, tissues do not take their fuel from the burgers directly. They take their fuel from the circulation. Or in other words, organs, tissues are fueled by circulating metabolites, which is the key word for my talk today. Circulating metabolites. So in my talk, I'm going to first identify the list of important circulating metabolites. I'll then focus on those metabolites and quantify their contribution to tissue TCA cycle and their sources. In the last section, I'm going to talk about how to determine the absolute interconverting fluxes between those circulating metabolites. So what are the important circulating metabolites? This is a necessary question, especially for my systems approach, because in system approach, you want to cover as many metabolites as possible. But the reality is that there are so many metabolites in circulation. It's simply impractical, extremely impractical to cover all of them. For example, in this serum metabolome database, there are thousands of them. I don't know what this means by the number of metabolites that are expected, but still there are at least hundreds, thousands of them in the blood circulation. It's impossible to cover all of them experimentally. So what are the important nutrients in blood circulation? To define the importance, I propose to measure the circulatory turnover flux of a nutrient in circulation. We refer to this as F-circ. F-circ of the nutrient is defined as the sum of the production fluxes of that nutrient by all tissues. The steady state also equals the sum of the consumption fluxes of that nutrient by all tissues. So it's really a measure of how involved a nutrient is participating in the whole body metabolism. How do we measure F-circ of a nutrient in circulation? We infuse isolated form of that nutrient to the blood. For example, glucose infuses the uniform carbohydrate labeled glucose to the blood circulation. Then we measure how much glucose is labeled in circulation and steady state. Then we can use this formula to calculate the F-circ for glucose. So to further, this is the key concept. So I want to spend more time to explain this F-circ. I'm going to use an analogy used by Professor Owen McGuinness at Vanderbilt University. I like this analogy a lot. Suppose you want to fight how many fish pass through the river per hour. We can introduce similar fish, say fish with different color and the no rate, 10 fish per hour. Then we catch fish downstream. Out of the 10 fish we caught, one is the fish we introduced? So from these numbers, we can immediately calculate the 90 fish per hour pass through the river per hour. So this formula is exactly the same as the one shown on the left here. Are the infusion rate of the labeled nutrient. In our example, it's 10 fish per hour. The L is the labeled fraction of glucose, the tracer or the tracer in general. In our example, it's 10% because out of 10 fish we caught, one is the labeled fish. So now, how do we do this experimentally. Here's my experimental setup. We infuse the isotope labeled tracers through a catheter that's planted on the mouse jugular vein. And the catheter is connected to the syringe pump through a setup of swivel and tether, which allows the mouse to freely move in the cage. So this way we make sure we probe the normal physiology of the mouse. And during infusion, we collect the blood samples from mouse and run the blood samples on mass spec to measure the labeled fraction. Since we know the infusion rate of the tracer we infuse, we can calculate the F-SER for that nutrient. So now with this setup, I wanted to systematically quantify the F-SER for the circulating metabolite. But again, we still have this problem, right? There are so many metabolites in circulation, thousands of them. It's just impractical to go through each of them to measure F-SERP for them. Fortunately, come to our rescue is the important physical upper bound on how fast F-SERP can be, because in this particular situation, F-SERP of nutrient is carried by the blood flow. So it's bounded by how fast the heart pumps blood or cardiac output. The upper bound is given by the cardiac output times the concentration of the nutrient. So even though mouse has really fast blood flow, still to be able to carry 10% of glucose F-SERP, the metabolite's concentration has to be greater than 30 micromolar. So I want to make an important note here that this concentration cutoff is a necessary condition, it's not a sufficient condition, which means even for concentration who has high concentration, sorry, for metabolite who has high concentration, it doesn't mean it's going to have high flux. But the metabolite that has low concentration means it's not going to have a big flux, okay? So now coming back to this criteria, 30 micromolar. It turns out it's a strong cutoff in the real situation. Only about 40 metabolites in circulation satisfy this criteria. So which is very easy, I mean, not easy, but can be handled experimentally. So I went on to quantify the F-SERP values for most of them, depending on tracer availability, and here's the result. And among these numbers, only 13 metabolites actually carry more than 10% of glucose F-SERP. So this is the list of important metabolites in circulation. In the following analysis, I'm going to focus on these 13 metabolites together with a combo of branching amino acids and 6 essential amino acids. In the following, I'm going to refer these metabolites as 15 nutrients. Okay. Then how do we quantify their contribution to tissue TCA? We know that TCA cycle is the predominant energy production pathway in tissues. The other pathway is glycolysis. So if we can quantify the contribution to tissue TCA cycle, we get a good approximation for the fuel usage by tissues. So to quantify the contribution of a nutrient, say X, to a tissue TCA, we can infuse a labeled form of nutrient X and measure how much a TCA cycle is labeled. We all know that there are multiple TCA intermediates. We choose malate and succinate for two reasons. First, they can be easily measured, reliably measured by our LC-MS system. A second reason, which is more important, is that their concentration in tissues are generally much higher than in blood circulation. This is very important because you do not want contamination from blood metabolites when you measure a tissue metabolites. So a contrary example is citrate, whose concentration between the tissue and the plasma is similar. So when you measure citrate labeling for tissue samples, it's hard to know. It really reflects what's going on in the tissues because you get a lot of contamination from blood citrate. Okay. So we divide the labeling of malate or succinate by the labeling of the infused tracer X in our example. We get normalized labeling. This reflects how much nutrient X contribute to a tissue TCA. Before I show you some data, I want to make another important note, which is that by labeling here, I refer to the fraction of labeled carbon atoms in the molecule. We know a molecule can have many numbers of carbon atoms, and they have different labeling patterns, or in a proper jargon, mass isotopomers. But here, I'm going to take the average value. Here's the exact definition for malate labeling. Basically, it goes through all the labeling pattern and it calculates for the average labeling for the malate, for that molecule. I know by this way, we ignore the valuable labeling pattern information, which is very informative for deducing fluxes, but at the same time, very hard to deal with, especially in the in vivo situation where things are complicated. It's definitely the future direction where you can infer reliably flux from this complicated labeling pattern information in a systematic way. But here in my talk, I'm just going to focus on this simple average labeling for molecules. Okay, now coming back to the normalized labeling of tissue TSA. Here's the data of normalized TSA labeling by Glisser. As you can see, it shows that for the brain, 30% of brain TSA is labeled by Glisser. Before we conclude that 30% of the brain TSA comes from Glisser, I want to bring up probably the most important message of my talk today, and that is normalized labeling is not direct contribution. What I mean is that 30% of the brain TSA labeling can come from glucose or lactate, as you can see, which are also labeled highly by glycerol infusion. So this so-called second tracer phenomena is in generally true. For example, in our example here, the X can label a TSA directly through X, but also can also indirectly through Y and Z. So the normalized labeling by X is really a combination of the direct contribution from X and also indirect contributions from many other nutrients in circulation. So we really need to calculate for the direct contribution, which is what we care. Indeed, a proper calculation of direct contribution, which I'm going to show you later, shows that it's very different from the normalized labeling data. As you can see, there's now really minimal direct contribution from glycerol to the brain. What's really happening is glycerol first labels glucose, and the glucose then goes to brain. Here's another example of TSA contribution by the glucose. The left green bar for tissue shows the normalized labeling data, and the right bar, the red black bar, is calculate direct contribution result. It shows that strikingly for most tissues except for the brain, there's really minimal direct contribution from glucose. As I'm going to show later, instead lactate is a more important carbohydrate substrate for TSA. So how do we calculate the direct contribution? We can run down a mass balance equation when we infuse a nutrient. For example, for X, on the right-hand side of the equation is a measured normalized labeling of TSA when we infuse X. The left-hand side is labeling coming from all three different sources, directly from X, indirectly from Y, and indirectly from Z. Okay, we can write down one mass balance equation for one infusion. We can write down three mass balance equations when you infuse all three of them separately. Now we have three unknowns, three direct contributions from X, Y, Z, but we have three equations we can solve for the direct contribution. Okay, this scheme can be generalized to any number of nutrients. So in our case, we have 15, right? So we went on to infuse each of the 15 nutrients and got 15 linear equations, which can be reformatted in a matrix format. M is the 15 times 15 matrix, summarizing the normalized labeling between every pair of 15 nutrients. And the right-hand side is the normalized TSA labeling by each of the 15 nutrients. Now we can solve for the direct contribution to TSA from each of the 15 nutrients. And here's the result. As you can see, we are able to account for more than 80%, in some cases, 100% of the direct contribution to tissue TSA for most tissues, except with some exceptions. So this comprehensive result confirmed many known features of metabolism. For example, brain use a lot of glucose. In our result, 65% of brain TSA comes from glucose. And the heart really loves fatty acid. In our result, it has the highest percentage of fat direct contribution. But our result also reveals many previously unknown features of tissue metabolism. For example, as I mentioned earlier, there's really minimal direct contribution from glucose to tissue, except for the brain. Glucose is shown in the purple color. You don't see much in any of the tissues except for the brain. Instead, lactate, which is shown in red color, is a major carbohydrate TCA substrate. This indicates a picture of glucose metabolism where glucose feeds the TCA cycle via circulating lactate. And among all the amino acids we infused, glutamine is really the most important amino acid in terms of being a fuel source. It is a major fuel for visceral tissues, including spleen, pancreas, and in small intestines. And the branching amino acids constitute about 15% of the pancreatic TCA. It's a major fuel for pancreas, but not much for other tissues. Like lactate, circulating acetate is a widely used fuel source by tissues, with exception for the brain. And the citrate is only used significantly by the kidney, which is shown in green color. You don't see much green color anywhere else except for the kidneys. Glycerol, showing black color, doesn't show up any of the bars, indicating that it's not an important TCA substrate. And the heart, among all the tissues, heart is unique in that it doesn't really burn any amino acids. And amino acids are shown in bluish color. You don't see much in the heart bar. Lastly, we are able to account for the majority of the direct contribution to tissue TCA, more than 80% for most tissues, except for the three tissues, which are the brown adipose tissue, white adipose tissue, and the liver, indicating that they utilize a lot of internal fuel sources in these tissues. So each of these observations is important biology and worth following up. For example, now we know glucose feeds the TCA cycle through circulating lactate. So we really have to be careful when we interpret the glucose uptake assay result, right? The higher glucose uptake by a tissue doesn't necessarily mean the higher glucose oxidation by that tissue. Could happen that glucose simply converted into lactate, which leads into circulation. So you have to think about what you mean by glucose clearance by that tissue. Another example I want to give is glutamine preference by pancreas. Since for a normal pancreas, they already use a lot of glutamine, so is the observed glutamine addiction phenomena in a pancreatic tumor really cancer specific? Okay, I had a brief discussion of of BCA usage by pancreas with Phil White, and he doesn't believe pancreatic island uses that much BCA. I have to say I don't know because we only focus on the bulk tissue, right? We collect the whole tissue and grind them, and then we run on mass spec. So it's really, we know there is a lot of heterogeneity in tissues. It's really a frontier to go into individual tissues to really look at individual cell types to measure their metabolism. While that's very, very challenging, before that, it's great that we can still see what's going on at the tissue level. So we did the same analysis, experiment analysis for fat mice, which is a lot of work, which we infused each of the 15 nutrients to fat mice and measure both the serum sample and the tissue sample, 11 tissue samples for each of the infusion. And the result is shown on the left bar for each tissue, and the right bar is what I have been talking about, which are for the fasted mice. The first overall observation is that really for most tissues, the few preferences are mostly maintained, with some exceptions. The exceptions are three tissues shown here. the brown adipose tissue, muscle, and heart, where you see a big jump of carbohydrate utilization from fast state to fat state, indicating that these tissues are most responsive to a fat fasting cycle, which are known for muscle and heart. I'm not sure this is a phenomenon for brown adipose tissue. Also interestingly, brown adipose tissue seems to stop utilizing internal fuel source in fat state. As you can see, we can account for close to 100% of the direct TCA contribution for brown fat in fat state. So that was the result for quantifying the contribution from those important signal nutrients to tissue TCA cycle. The other important question is where the nutrients coming from, right? For example, lactate is not part of the food, where it's coming from. To answer this question, we can still utilize the same labeling data to look at how much lactate is labeled by different nutrient. For example, if we're interested in how much lactate comes from glycerol, we can look at how much lactate is labeled by glycerol. Again, as in the case of TCA direct contribution quantification, there is a difference between the normalized labeling and the direct contribution, because here the lactate labeling from glycerol can come either directly from glycerol or indirectly through glucose. So we really need to do a similar type of linear algebra calculation to obtain the direct contribution from one nutrient to another nutrient. Okay, here the result for lactate, the direct contribution from each of the 14 nutrients to lactate. Also show on the left bar, the normalized labeling data for lactate. As you can see, even though there is a lot of glycerol labeling into lactate, but there is really minimal direct contribution from glycerol to lactate. What's really happening is glycerol doesn't really take this pathway from this pathway. What's happening is glycerol first goes to glucose through gluconeogenesis, and it's glucose that directly contributes to lactate. So we did this for each of the 15 nutrients, and here's the result. Again, as in the case of TCA contribution quantification, this comprehensive result reviews the many things we already know. For example, for glucose, the major substrates are lactate, alanine and glycerol. Also for the keto bodies through hydroxybutyrate, the major sources are fatty acids, which are showing yellow here. Our result also review many previously unknown results. For example, palmitate, unlike essential fatty acids, oleate and lanolate, the palmitic acid can be made de novo from other nutrients. But the fact that we don't see any direct contribution from any of the signal nutrients indicating that the newly synthesized palmitate acid probably goes to the storage first, which is probably adipose triglycerides. And only about 10% of the free glycerol comes from lactate and the glucose, indicating that most of the glycerol comes from degradation of triglycerides in adipose tissue. Another interesting result is that the fatty acids are a major source for acid, with only about 10% of acid coming from carbohydrate, lactate. We're missing about half source for acid, which are principally from microbiota, as shown in our speaker yesterday, Rachel Perry's work. And for amino acids, their missing part can be explained by the degradation of proteins. For example, glutamine, alanine, serine glycine. The missing part of the contribution can come from protein degradation, but there is no storage for citrate. Our result indicate a missing source for citrate. So also did this analysis for mice in fat state, and the result are shown on the left bar for each nutrient. And now in fat state, there is a lot of incoming glucose flux from food. That's why you see a reduced direct contribution from the circulating nutrient. This is probably also the case for serine, where there's probably serine incoming fluxes from the food. What's interesting is that we also see a drop of direct contribution for 3-hydroxybutyrate and acetate, indicating there are probably there exist some dietary associated sources for these nutrients. What could happen for acetate that with more food intake, the microbiota take a bigger role in acetate production. So now I have covered both the quantification of contribution to tissue TCA and also their sources for the circulating metabolites. In the last section, I'm going to show that we can actually obtain even more flux information from the infusion experiments, which are the absolute fluxes between circulating nutrients. So far I have been talking about relative flux information. For example, in the last section, we talked about the direct contribution from one nutrient to another nutrient, for example, glucose. 16% of lactate comes from, 16% of glucose comes from lactate. So the units are percentage, right? It's all relative units. 16% of glucose comes from alanine and 29% of glucose comes from glycerol. What I'm going to show here, actually we can get real flux number in nanomole per minute per gram for this interconverting fluxes between circulating nutrients. I'm not going to bother you with all the technical details. If you're interested, you can refer to this preprint on bioarchive. But the basic idea is that we take advantage of the F-circ measurements for glucose, which is real flux in units of nanomole per minute per gram. Right? We relate that to the total flux through glucose. If we know the total flux through glucose, we can of course calculate the individual contributing of fluxes from each of the nutrients, as we know the relative contribution numbers. So the key is to calculate this converting factor between the F-circ value and the total flux through glucose. This converting factor can be calculated from the direct contribution values between the 15 nutrients. Again, if you're interested, please refer to the supplemental note in the supplemental materials of my preprint. So we can do this calculation for each nutrient. The result would be a fully connected flux network between circulating nutrients, between each pair of the circulating nutrients. Here only show the part of network that has the highest flux, okay? To really focus on the major fluxes, the result tells us is the metabolic cycle that involves three nutrients, glucose, lactate, alanine. And also there's a big flux from glycerol to glucose. Okay. And from our previous result of TCA contribution quantification, we know there's no direct contribution from glucose and the glycerol to TCA, and there is direct contribution from lactate alanine. And the fat state result shows that the same cycle involving glucose, alanine, and the lactate still persists, indicating that regardless of the food intake, this cycle just goes on. Now I want to take a very brief detour to point out that our data actually indicate another major metabolic cycle, and which is the triglyceride fatty acid cycle. Show on the left, the bar graph is the comparison between the dietary intake of flux and the F-circ measurements in both fat and fast states for the major nutrients. A glaring feature here is that you really don't see much fatty acids in the food intake for this high carbohydrate chow for the mouse. But the fatty acids really carry huge fluxes in both fat and fast states internally. This indicates a high flux on this metabolic cycle between triglycerides and the free fatty acids. Now we can merge the two metabolic cycles together, and the connection is through glycerol. These are really the major fluxes at the whole body level. If we think about the many in vivo fluxes as rivers in the United States, these cycles show here are the major rivers like Mississippi River or Colorado River. So with that, I want to summarize what I have told you today. I have told you a framework of flux analysis for circulating metabolites. It includes the identification of important circulating metabolites, the quantification of the contribution to tissue TCA cycle and their sources, and also the determination of absolute interconverting fluxes between them. So I hope I've convinced you that this flux framework is powerful in terms of revealing new biology and generating new hypotheses. This flux omics approach can be readily applied to other physiological or disease states to review really what's going on metabolically in animals. So in the last part, I'm going to take advantage of this important opportunity to introduce my lab a little bit more. So in my own lab, I'm going to take the systems and quantitative approach to understand diseases with disrupted energy imbalance, including both the energy surplus diseases like obesity and also the energy deficit disease state like cancer cachexia. I will still going to continue developing methods of in vivo flux quantification by innovating along three directions: animal experiments, analytical methods, and modeling. I really believe being able to reliably measure flux in vivo is not only valuable for research, but also has strong potential in clinical applications in future. I'm looking forward to, if you're interested in my research, please check out my website. I'm looking forward for questions on Twitter about this talk, also more stimulating scientific interactions in future. Thank you very much for listening, and importantly, stay well. Thank you, bye.